Well, hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out and joining me today for our Marx Brothers class. Class tried to start all on its own there, but we won't be having any of that. Looks like we got a fair few people in the room tonight. We're a minute or so before seven. We're going to give people another minute or two to show up and get comfortable before we start the class. In the meantime, we've got the comments going there on the side. If anybody has any questions at any point, please feel free to put them in the comments and I will happily answer them after the presentation. But we do have a couple of minutes before class starts here. So if anybody wants to throw something into the comments, I will be happy to answer it or talk about it. Is there anything anybody's watching these days? I assume we are all caught up on Tiger King at this point. That's almost yesterday's news. Trying to think what else I've been enjoying. I've been enjoying the current season of Killing Eve that just started over on BBC America. If you like spies and murder, that's a good show for you. I've also been enjoying The Plot Against America over on HBO. That's the new show from the guys behind The Wire. I've been enjoying it very much. It's about an alternate history thing about anti-Semitism in America. So as you can tell, I've been watching some pretty heavy stuff. I've also been binge watching a lot of episodes of The Goldbergs on Hulu. Had never seen that show before. Like that a lot. That's a much lighter show. But anyway, let's see here. We're going to give it another minute or so before we start the class. No one wants to comment to me. That's fine. I'm used to it, folks. I hope everybody's doing okay. I hope everybody's comfortable and everybody is safe. I assume everybody here is Minnesotan. I think you're all people that I know. So we all just found out from the governor that we're going to be sticking around our houses for at least another 2 weeks. So that's very exciting. I will have one more class yet in that time period for you though. So that's something I don't know that I'm going to say that you can look forward to, but it is a thing that will happen. Let's go ahead and get started with our class tonight, though. We're going to be talking all about the Marx Brothers. My name is Eric Houston. I'm the studio manager over at North Metro TV, and a big part of my job is presenting programs like this to the community, and I've been happy to present them over YouTube these last couple of weeks. If you have any questions, please put them in the comments. I'll be happy to answer them. And if you like the class and you've never been before and you want updates on when there will be more, email me at Eric, that's E-R-I-C, at northmetrotv.com. I'll put you on my mailing list and you'll find out all about all of the different classes that I have to offer. But now, without any further ado, the Marx Brothers. The Marx Brothers were the undisputed kings of anarchist comedy in the 1930s and 1940s. There were five brothers, although most people are most familiar with about three of them. There's Harpo, the silent, mischievous harp-playing prankster who could materialize props seemingly from nowhere. Chico, the clever con artist with the phony Italian accent and penchant for comically mistaking words and phrases, and Groucho, whose quick wit and quick mind devastated society types and left audiences in stitches as they tried to keep up. Again, there were five Marx brothers, and they were the sons of Minnie and Sam, or Frenchie Marx. Minnie was born in Germany, and she had show business in her blood. Her parents were a yodeling harpist and a ventriloquist slash magician. Sam was born in France, hence the nickname Frenchie, and he was a tailor, although by all accounts, a very poor tailor. Their first son, Manfred, was born in 1886, but sadly died 7 months later, devastating Minnie. The second son, Leonard, later Chico, was born in 1887. Minnie doted on him, giving him all of the love that she was unable to give to Manfred. In her eyes, young Leonard could do no wrong, even though he was already a compulsive gambler by the age of 12. He was also a natural piano player and developed his unusual comedic playing style on his own, and rarely, if ever, practiced. Marx was born in 1888 and changed his name to Arthur in 1911 amidst pre-war anti-German sentiment. He later became famous as Harpo Marx. He was a good and dutiful son, in contrast to Chico's bad habits. Musical like Chico, he learned to play the harp himself. Besides the harp, perhaps the thing most associated with Harpo is this face, which Harpo called the Gookie. It was a face that he first saw as a young boy when he saw a man making this very face while rolling cigars in a cigar store window. Young Harpo was fascinated by the face and went home to learn to master it. When he had it down, he returned to the cigar store window and banged on the glass. When the man looked up, he made the face right back at him, enraging the man, but busting up his brothers. Born next was Julius, who would later be world famous as Groucho Marx. He was born in 1890 and was a quiet and intellectual young man who was careful with money, especially in comparison to Chico. He was also musical and was a talented boy soprano, but his ambition was to become a doctor. That ambition, though, would be dashed when he was forced to drop out of school at the age of 12 to join his brothers in vaudeville. Milton, later Gummo Marx, was born in 1892, and the youngest brother, Herbert, also known as Zeppo, was born in 1901. The five brothers grew up together in a poor neighborhood in New York's Upper East Side. Now, we already talked about how Minnie had show business in her blood because of her parents. Well, it also extended to her brother and the boy's uncle, who was Al Sheehan, who was half of vaudeville's famous Gallagher and Sheehan comedy team. Minnie wanted her boys to follow in his footsteps. Plus, she reasoned all the boys, except for Groucho, were playing hooky anyway. So Minnie decided to get them into show business so she would at least know where they all were and that they were all somewhere together. She became the quintessential stage mother and started them out as a singing act called the Four Nightingales. They toured the country in small, rundown theaters to little notice. Groucho would later say they were hopelessly average. In 1910, the four oldest brothers, without Zeppo, had a performance in a small Texas town. The boys were singing on stage as they normally did when a man burst into the theater yelling, "Runaway mule." The audience began to file out of the theater, wanting to go outside and see the mule. Groucho was furious. When the crowd eventually began to file back into the theater, he began to berate the audience, calling them names and hurling insults at them for daring to leave in the middle of the show. Luckily, the audience thought it was hilarious. Joining in on the fun, Harpo began to crawl under a rug the entire length of the stage, and Chico began his trademark piano playing. The audience was in stitches. In that moment, the Marx Brothers were reborn as a comedy team. They proceeded to adapt existing vaudeville material into a skit they called Fun in High School that they toured with for years. Here is where they developed their familiar comedic personas, all of the boys using ethnic accents, as was the style at the time. Chico became an Italian comedian, a premise that he kept up throughout his career. Harpo donned a curly red wig to become an Irish character. Groucho's character was German, and he painstakingly applied the makeup to his eyebrows and mustache every night. However, he eventually became tired of trying to make them look realistic and just started smearing them on, resulting in the familiar Groucho makeup that we know today. He again also performed with a German accent, but dropped the accent during World War I when audiences began to boo his character. He did, however, keep the eyebrows and mustache. Speaking of the war, Gummo left the group when he was drafted into the army during the First World War and was replaced by Zeppo. Gummo never much liked performing anyway and went into the raincoat business, where he was a great success. He later became a talent agent, representing his brother Groucho and helping to develop the sitcom The Life of Riley. People always wonder where the brothers' nicknames came from. Well, it was about this time, just before Gummo left for the war, that the brothers, at least the four oldest brothers, were playing poker with a comedian named Art Fisher. Fisher was famous for giving nicknames and for giving nicknames that stuck. And he was in the habit of ending those nicknames with the letter O, something that he had adopted from a popular comic strip that featured all of the characters with names ending in the letter O. And as he dealt the cards, he gave the brothers their nicknames. Gummo became Gummo because he always wore rubber overshoes or gum shoes over his fancy shoes. Harpo was easy. He's Harpo because he plays the harp. Chico was so named because he liked to do what was known at the time as chasing the chickens or chasing girls. Groucho's nickname is disputed. It may be because he wore a garment around his neck called a grouch bag to keep his money in, and that he wore that thing even when he slept. But it's just as likely that he was nicknamed Groucho because he was a grouchy guy. Zeppo is the only one of the brothers not to have been named by Art Fisher, but to have been named by his brothers. And again, there's some dispute over where the name Zeppo came from. Groucho always insisted that the nickname came because Zeppo was born around the time of the first Zeppelins arriving in New York City. But the timeline doesn't quite match up with that. It's possibly because Zeppo and Chico used to refer to each other as children as Zeke and Zeb, eventually Zeppo and then Zeppo, in the style of a series of jokes about Midwesterners where the characters were called Zeke and Zeb. Think Sven and Oli, but for the Indiana set. Or it's possible that the name Zeppo came from a chimp named Zippo who belonged to a vaudeville performer the boys used to work with. They met the chimp and then began to torture their younger brother by calling him Zippo and eventually Zeppo. Whatever the reasons, the name stuck, and the brothers were becoming more and more popular. But Minnie, as their mother and as their manager, wanted them to become even more popular. In 1914, she buys a full-page ad in Variety, and in the ad promises that the boys would sell out any house that hired them or play for free. Now, Minnie had no reason to believe that her sons, talented as they were, could sell out large vaudeville houses, but she felt that it was worth the gamble, and it paid off. soon the bookings began to roll in, and at much nicer theaters than they had been used to playing in, leading eventually even to the Palace Theater, vaudeville's premier venue. By this time, they'd changed the name of their show to Home Again and asked Uncle Al Sheehan to write some new material. He did, but he forgot to write any lines for Harpo. That forced Harpo to ad lib during the entire first night of the show. Of course, a reviewer was in the audience and he was unkind, saying that nothing that Harpo said during the show was as funny as the lines by the rest of his brothers. Then and there, Harpo swore to never again speak on stage.
You know, I'd be lost without a telephone. Hey, don't go away. I want to talk to you. Now, where were we? Oh, yes. Now that you're Secretary of War, what kind of an army do you think we ought to have?
Well, I tell you what I think. I think we should have a standing army.
Why should we have a standing army?
Because then we save money on chairs.
Peanuts. Scat! Say, who are you anyway? I don't go in much for modern art. Have you got anything by one of the old masters? Not bad. You don't happen to have her telephone number. Say, you could be a big help to me. Where do you live? Well, it's not much of a place, but it's home.
Meow!
Oh my goodness. Folks, I have to apologize really quickly. I have been caught flat-footed. My notes are out of order, and there we go. Chico wanted to expand on this newfound success, and he wanted to move the brothers to Broadway. Harpo, Zeppo, and Groucho weren't so sure. They were worried that their act wasn't high class enough for the Great White Way. A cartoonist who was friends with Chico, though, had an idea for a play that could be made with leftover props. Chico peppered in existing Marx Brothers bits to create a play called I'll Say She Is. It was a hit. A 1931 promotional film duplicates the opening scene, the only part of the act that was ever filmed.
What do you think you are?
Hey, wait a minute. You know who this is?
No.
He sells Frankfurters at the Merchant of Wieners.
Well, what do you want? My name is What Do You Care? My home is anywhere. People say I'm awful dumb, so I thought to you I'd come. Say, listen, what is...
The brothers followed up I'll Say She Is with The Coconuts, which was another big Broadway hit. They premiered this one in 1925 and toured with it until 1928. The play was a musical that also featured songs by the great Irving Berlin. Margaret Dumont was also featured in the class. Dumont, whose name may be familiar to the Marx Brothers fans out there, was a Broadway actress of some renown and the widow of millionaire industrialist John Moeller Jr. She was the perfect straight woman whose real-life society airs would serve her well as an anchor in the middle of all of the Marx Brothers' chaos. She fit so well that she would appear in two of their stage shows and seven movies. Groucho later referred to her as practically the fifth Marx Brother.
Mr. Driftwood, 3 months ago, you promised to put me into society. In all that time, you've done nothing but draw a very handsome salary.
You think that's nothing, huh? How many men do you suppose are drawing a handsome salary nowadays? Why, you can count them on the fingers of one hand, my good woman.
I'm not your good woman.
Don't say that, Mrs. Claypool. I don't care what your past has been. To me, you'll always be my good woman, because I love you. There. I didn't mean to tell you, but you dragged it out of me. I love you.
It's rather difficult to believe that when I find you dining with another woman.
The rumor that Dumont didn't get the Marx Brothers jokes or know that she was in a comedy movie is simply false, and ironically was most likely started by Groucho, who liked to tell the story and who was never one to let the truth get in the way of a good story. In fact, Dumont specialized in comedies, appearing in similar roles for other comedians. She appeared in more than 50 movies and worked alongside such comedic legends as Wheeler and Woolsey, Red Skelton, Jack Benny, Gabby Hayes, Abbott and Costello, Laurel and Hardy, and W.C. Fields. The brothers followed the Coconuts with Animal Crackers, which was another Broadway smash in 1928, and it couldn't have come at a better time. 1928, coincidentally, was also the year of the jazz singer, and the year that sound finally came to the movies. Audiences immediately were interested in more sound movies. They didn't want to see silent pictures anymore. They just wanted talkies. And Hollywood became desperate for performers who could act and speak and be dynamic on camera and who had things to say that audiences wanted to hear. The Marx Brothers were exactly who Hollywood was looking for. But the brothers were leery about moving into motion pictures. They had tried once before in 1921 with a film called Humorisk. It was the first script from Joe Swerling, who would later be famous for writing the movies It's a Wonderful Life and Gone with the Wind. But while those movies are classics, Humorisk was an unmitigated creative disaster. It was poorly received in part because the brothers abandoned their usual comedic characters to play different characters in the movie. Harpo was a detective and the hero of the piece. Groucho sported a long mustache and black costume to play a sort of stereotypical silent movie villain, kind of like Snidely Whiplash. Chico played Groucho's henchman, and Zeppo played a dashing playboy who owns the local nightclub. Groucho supposedly burned the negative himself after one particularly disastrous preview. However it happened, the film was never released and is now lost. Interestingly, Harpo would be the first of the brothers to appear in the movies when he was visiting a friend on the set of the 1925 silent film, Too Many Kisses. While he was visiting his friend, that movie's director approached Harpo and asked if Harpo would like to appear in a small role. Harpo agreed. Did any of you catch anything different or strange about that clip? Harpo speaks. Harpo has a line of dialogue in this movie, and of course, it is the perfect bit of Marx Brothers irony that the only time Harpo ever spoke on camera was in a silent movie. Still, the brothers eventually came around to the idea of making movies and began filming an adaptation of The Coconuts for Paramount. They shot the film during the day and appeared in Animal Crackers on stage at night. Coconuts is, by its nature, an early sound film, which led to a great number of difficulties. The early sound technology just was not yet up to snuff, and it created a lot of problems on set. The camera, for example, was loud. The motor of the camera was so loud that it was being picked up by the microphone, so the camera had to be placed inside of a soundproof box. Once it was inside that box, it couldn't be moved, leading to the film having a very static feeling as all of the shots are just the camera in one place for several minutes at a time. Another interesting problem was that the mere rustling of paper would cause the sensitive microphones to overload. This led the director to soak every piece of water in the every piece of paper in the movie in water. The brothers were once again dissatisfied with the results and again sought to block the film from showing. Paramount ignored their concerns and released the film anyway. The resulting film is, to be honest, unremarkable in a lot of ways. The static camera work is problematic, and the various songs are unmemorable. The Coconuts is unlike a lot of later Marx Brothers movies in that the Marx Brothers are frequently off camera, and we spend a great deal of time on these sort of musical numbers. And indeed, the audiences were lukewarm at best about the songs and other musical elements, but they absolutely loved the Marx Brothers. And it was on their backs alone that Coconuts became one of the biggest hits of the early sound era. It rocketed the brothers to national fame. With the release of their first movie, the brothers had already been performing for 25 years, and Harpo and Chico were already in their 40s. Paramount, though, was eager for another film, and the brothers followed Coconuts with an adaptation of Animal Crackers. Both the technology and writing had been fine-tuned to create an unequivocal film classic. In many ways, the first true Marx Brothers film. It exhibited their comedy style perfectly, which featured a complete disinterest in plot, heroes, villains, romance, and other typical conventions of movies and storytelling in favor of anarchy and chaos. The world of the early Marx Brothers films was one where anything could happen, so long as it was funny. And if the story tried to get in their way, it could go jump in a lake.
Call me Snara.
Hooray, hooray, hooray!
He went into the jungle, where all the monkeys throw nuts.
If I stay here, I'll go nuts.
Hooray, hooray, hooray!
Incidentally, the name Captain Spaulding was taken from a real-life character who was one of Hollywood's premier cocaine dealers. The brothers would enjoy two more hits with Monkey Business and Horse Feathers, both of which were original films as opposed to having been adapted from the stage. For these two films, Margaret Dumont would be replaced by comic actress Thelma Todd. The plots of these films, such as they were, required a younger, more conventionally pretty actress for the brothers to pitch woo at. But Todd was not just a pretty face. She had a fascinating career in comedies in her own right, appearing alongside Buster Keaton and Jimmy Durante and Laurel and Hardy before dying under mysterious circumstances. Duck Soup was the brothers' final film for Paramount, and it was a turbulent production. Paramount was facing bankruptcy, and the brothers were worried that they would never get the money that the studio already owed them, and so they started a bitter contract dispute. This, combined with arguments over the script and the title, led to creating a much more difficult mood on set. Despite this, Duck Soup is seen by modern critics and by yours truly as one of the great anti-war satires and the greatest of the Marx Brothers films, in part because it almost completely ignores plot and embraces that utter chaos that the boys thrive in. Duck Soup has far less plot even than Animal Crackers or their other earlier movies, allowing them to really just indulge in the comedy. It's also due in part to the classic bits in the film, like the immortal mirror scene, which was adapted from their vaudeville act and which was also used by comedians like Harold Lloyd and Charlie Chaplin, and which Harpo would reuse years later on I Love Lucy. Critics of the day, however, did not like the film. They didn't like its politics, and they didn't like its lack of plot. And while Duck Soup was successful, it was not as successful as the earlier Marx Brothers movies. That, along with the bitter production, led Paramount to decide they were uninterested in future Marx Brothers films. With the Paramount contract over, Zeppo decided to leave the act. He became a highly successful engineer and formed a talent agency with his brother Gummo. Zeppo is the ignored or forgotten Marx brother, which is a shame because he too is very talented. And his brothers often considered him to be the most talented among them, in part because he knew each of his brothers' parts in all of their shows by heart and was an excellent mimic. So if ever Groucho or Harpo or Chico were sick, Zeppo would put on their costume and substitute in for the play, and no one would ever know the difference. While his screen character isn't as flashy as his brothers, Zeppo is an integral part of their chemistry. And he was often cast as the romantic straight man role, but rather than playing those roles as milquetoast or sincere and romantic, he often played them in a decidedly arch manner and could easily transition from the romance stuff to the zaniness of his brothers.
I've been busy arguing with Dad about you. How many?
Two. Well, what about me?
Dad wants me to give you up. You know, you're interfering with my studies.
He must think I'm terrible.
But I think you're wonderful. You're beautiful.
Are you making love to me?
Why not?
As the remaining three brothers were contemplating a return to Broadway, Chico's gambling finally really paid off when he began discussing the brothers' future with Irving Thalberg during a game of bridge. Thalberg was MGM's boy wonder, who had become their head of production at the age of only 26. He shepherded countless movies to great success, thanks to a preternatural ability to pair the right scripts with the right stars, directors, and film crews. Thalberg is responsible for Lon Chaney's Hunchback of Notre Dame, the 1925 silent version of Ben-Hur, The Good Earth, and Mutiny on the Bounty. Thalberg felt that Paramount had misused the brothers and offered Chico a generous contract. He also gave them immense support, giving their movies bigger budgets, better crew and equipment, and an entire unit of gag and scriptwriters to turn their next picture into a genuine MGM Hollywood spectacle, complete with elaborate non-comedic musical numbers that were bigger set pieces than anything seen in previous Marx Brothers films. Thalberg felt Paramount had missed you. Oh, we talked about that. But what we do want to talk about is that Thalberg was also interested in having these new movies adhere more strictly to typical storytelling norms. The Marxist comedy would interweave now with a straightforward romantic plot, making the brothers more sympathetic as they tried to assist young lovers, as opposed to their usual zaniness in attempting to con people out of their money. There would also now be an overt villain for them to be frustrated by, rather than for them to simply go up against society types that they just tormented. And there would be a more structured story, including a point at which the brothers would find themselves at a low point near the end of the story that they would have to rebound from. Results would remove much of the anarchy from the earlier pictures, but would help to make the movies more understandable and relatable. These would essentially be Marx Brothers movies for everyone, the chaos carefully controlled, as if the brothers had invaded a more typical Hollywood picture.
I came to mop up.
Just the woman I'm looking for. Come right ahead. You'll have to start on the ceiling. It's the only place that isn't being occupied.
You can clean my shoes if you want.
I'll clean it. Tell Aunt Minnie to send up a bigger room, too, will you?
Stuart?
Ah, come right ahead.
Hey, Tomasso, the food!
Been waiting all afternoon.
Food! Here comes the food.
Come on.
So in any event, A Night at the Opera was the Marx Brothers' first picture with MGM. And for the first time, the brothers felt truly respected. Thalberg encouraged the boys to take their material out on the road once more and tour it out on stage live in front of audiences. This allowed the brothers to rebuild their confidence and echoed their Broadway beginnings, when night after night of performing had allowed them to hone their best bits in coconuts and animal crackers long before going in front of the camera. In fact, if you ever notice a long pause after a bit of dialogue from Groucho or Chico, that's there on purpose. While performing on stage, the brothers would time the laughs their lines would get and then leave that exact amount of time in the movie so audiences wouldn't be laughing over the different lines. The young lovers in the picture would be played not by comedians, but by straight actors, including Kitty Carlisle of To Tell the Truth fame, and Alan Jones taking over for Zeppo and playing the role with all of the earnest sincerity that Zeppo had quietly mocked. A Night at the Opera would be the biggest hit of their career and would be followed soon after by A Day at the Races, made very much in the same mold. Unfortunately, Thalberg died suddenly during the production and future executives would never give the brothers the same level of support. As a result, their next three films for the studio would be middling, unmemorable affairs. The boys largely decided to retire from film. They were in their 50s and Harpo and Groucho no longer needed to work. However, Chico's gambling problem would force him to work the rest of his life. His debts would spark two more films as his brothers tried to help dig him out of a hole. Chico would also make numerous appearances on the nascent medium of television, trying to make ends meet, and even convinced his brothers to co-star in a television series called Deputy Sheriff, where Harpo and Chico played bumbling angels. Groucho would appear only occasionally as their boss.
Hey, you don't look like an angel. Disguise yourself. No, no. Put on your halo.
Halo.
Halo. Your halo. You watch.
The pilot was never actually finished, though. Chico couldn't remember his lines and later proved uninsurable when doctors discovered that he suffered from a hardening of the arteries. Instead, Chico would take his act to Europe while occasionally appearing in summer stock alongside Harpo in a Vegas act. Outside of occasionally appearing alongside Chico when his brother needed the money, Harpo largely retired from the film industry. He enjoyed spending time with his family and had a weird hobby. He would find lost dogs on the street and bring them home, then read newspaper ads to reunite the pets with their owners. He too would make occasional TV appearances, but really only when the offer interested him artistically, such as beer ads for Labatt's, which he was allowed to make in a surrealist fashion that was inspired in part by his friendship with Salvador Dali. He also wrote an autobiography called Harpo Speaks before appearing in a live farewell concert for his friends. Harpo played a number of beautiful melodies on the harp before concluding with a speech. It was the first time since he had adopted the Harpo character that he spoke on stage. As the speech kept going and going, the audience started laughing harder and harder. Harpo hadn't spoken in public in 50 years, but now you couldn't shut him up. Groucho, meanwhile, had long been hesitant about appearing on television. He starred in three radio programs, all of which that failed, including one called Flywheel, Shyster, and Flywheel that co-starred Chico. One night, a television producer saw Groucho appear on stage with Bob Hope shortly into the night. Both discarded their scripts and ad-libbed to a hysterical audience. The producer approached Groucho about doing something similar on a game show where he could, in essence, ad-lib and tease the contestants.
10 years. What was your reason for coming to this country? I assume you had a reason, huh?
I sure have. I met a soldier. I met him in a dance hall.
In Italy?
Yes.
I thought he went over there to fight.
I guess he did. He fought.
He was fighting in a dance hall?
No. He was fight after the war was over.
Oh. He went right from the war to a dance hall?
Yes. Oh, well, no.
You Bet Your Life started on the radio in 1947 and transitioned to television in 1950, where it ran until 1961. It was one of the longest running shows of its era, but was not a hit at first. Big ratings would not come until the second year, which also saw Groucho win a prestigious Peabody Award. While the show had a brief quiz element and the hook of a bonus prize if a contestant happened to say a secret word, it was really mostly about Groucho ad-libbing and teasing the contestants. Contestants were vetted carefully and selected from newspaper stories so that Groucho would be guaranteed to have some material to work with. The loose ad-lib style meant that each 24-minute episode took roughly 45 minutes to tape. Editors would then select only the best bits for air, but did keep many of the show's more risque bloopers for their own private reel.
Well, now, suppose you became a famous actress and then you met somebody you liked and got married. Would you be willing to quit acting and be a housewife and a mother?
Well, I think if you keep your feet on the ground, you can combine both. That's what I would like to do.
Well, if you keep your feet on the ground, you'll never be a mother. Waste of film.
Primarily, the big objective, Groucho, will be to migrate the people by space vehicle to other planets that have more desirable temperatures.
You're going to have to put your shoes on again, you know.
It is getting deep, ain't it?
Yeah.
Pardon me just a minute. I hate to interrupt this, but have you read this book?
No, sir.
Well, hold it. I'll be right back. Now that we've all seen action, let's have a little action on the show.
Groucho was joined on the show by announcer George Fenneman, with whom he had a unique chemistry, with Groucho calling him the male Margaret Dumont. You may recognize Fenneman from his role in The Thing from Another World, but you probably also know his voice from this.
The story you are about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Yes, George Fenneman was the voice of Dragnet. After it went off the air, You Bet Your Life reruns continued to air in syndication for years. And those reruns were very popular, thanks in large part to the spontaneous nature of the shows that made them so rewatchable. The popularity of the reruns led to a sort of Marx Brothers renaissance in the 1960s, as college students in the counterculture movement rediscovered and embraced the Marx Brothers anarchic style. Around this time, Billy Wilder, the famous director of movies like The Apartment, The 7-Year Itch, and Sunset Boulevard, began working on a new Marx Brothers movie called A Day at the UN. But those plans were scuttled when Chico passed away in 1961, aged 74 from a hardening of the arteries. Harpo would pass away in 1964 at age 75. It was a day after having heart surgery and the day of his 28th wedding anniversary. Groucho's son Arthur said Harpo's funeral was the only time he ever saw his father cry. Gummo would pass away of a cerebral hemorrhage in 1977. He was 86, and his death was kept from Groucho, who had grown so ill, his doctors were worried that the news would kill him. And Groucho did indeed pass 4 months later of pneumonia, also aged 86. Zeppo, the youngest, would be the last to pass on in 1979 of lung cancer. He was 78. Thanks to their films, though, the Marx Brothers may be gone, but they'll never truly be forgotten. The Five Brothers have crafted an immortal and impressive legacy that will be cherished by generations to come as more new and newer audiences embrace their comedy, find those classic bits, and learn what the Marx Brothers were all about. I want to thank you very much for joining me this evening for this look at the Marx Brothers. My name is Eric Houston. You can follow me online at Movie Man Eric on Facebook and on Twitter. If you enjoyed this class and you would like to be informed about more classes, you can email me at Eric, that's E-R-I-C, at northmetrotv.com, and I'll be happy to put you on our email list so you can find out when we're having more classes just like this one. If you haven't already, I'd like to encourage you to leave a comment here on the video. And if you have any questions about what you've seen, I'll be happy to answer them in a moment. First, I do want to tell you about the classes that we have coming up. On May the 12th, I'll be back right here on YouTube Live with a class about the Three Stooges. We can hardly have a class about the Marx Brothers without following up with the other famous comedic trio of the 1930s and 40s. So we'll be looking all at the Stooges' career. Then in June 4th, we will have a special class about the history of game shows. We'll be looking specifically at game shows of the 1950s and 1960s and at the famous game show scandal and how that reverberated through the industry. We'll follow that class up on June the 18th with another class about game shows, this time of the 70s and 80s, where we will look at popular game shows like Jeopardy, Wheel of Fortune, Match Game, and Let's Make a Deal. We'll learn how those shows were made, and we'll also take a look at a couple of new game show scandals that rocked the worlds of The Price is Right and the one with the whammies. The name's escaping me, right? Press Your Luck. We'll take a look at the Press Your Luck scandal. But now I am turning on my thing here to see if anybody had any questions they wanted answered. It does not look like it. Donald said, thank you for doing these presentations. They're a great diversion. Well, thank you very much for coming and watching them, Donald. Without you watching them, I wouldn't be able to keep doing them. So I do appreciate that. Let me see here. I was going to go to full screen here. Let's see. Cindy asked if that is my cursor on the screen. Yes, Cindy, that was my cursor on the screen. The computer is supposed to forget that the cursor is there and not show it to you, but sometimes it does. And then there's not really a whole lot I can do about it. Let's see here. Jill says, I think that we are back. She is right. I am very sorry that we had a flash of technical difficulties in the middle there sometimes. That can happen when I'm trying to share the movie clips over YouTube, but thank you. It looks like most of you stayed and through and weathered that little storm. So I appreciate you for that. Let's see here. It looks like Annette Dutcher says, thanks so much, Eric. Annette, you are more than welcome. It's my absolute pleasure to do these. These are absolutely one of my favorite things to do. The Three Stooges class is all ready to go, but I've been working the last couple of days at putting together the game show classes, and I've been having a really great time watching clips of old game shows and putting those classes together, and I'm really excited to share those with you. I'm sure some of you are wondering when we might get back to having these classes live and in person. To be completely honest with you, right now, I don't know when that might be. It's hard to imagine that anytime soon we'll be able to have the classes at the TV station again and get 30 or 40 people in sort of close quarters in a room together like that. But rest assured, I will keep doing classes just like this on YouTube Live so that you can all enjoy them. And I'll keep posting them afterwards so you can share them with friends and enjoy them some more later. So I'm looking to see here. It doesn't look like anybody had any other questions. So we will wrap up our look at the Marx Brothers tonight. Again, I want to thank you for joining me. It's been a lot of fun and an absolute pleasure. I hope that you all have a great night and that you're all staying safe and taking care of yourselves and taking care of each other. I'll see you again on May 12th with that class about the Three Stooges.